not going to be figuring out work here. We're going to be figuring out total force from water pressure on the side of the dam. Still use the same shape, trapezoid, but let's let the distances be different. Let's let this distance here be 1,000 meters. Let's let this one be 200 meters. So now we're using SI units to start with. And let's let this distance here be 1,500 meters. Oh, I shouldn't have used blue to start with. Oh, that was going to be my water. Okay, we got green water. The assumption, the implicit assumption, is the water level is up to the top of the dam. Do they say that? It's implicit. So water is exerting pressure on the entire dam. Even though the dam is sideways, water pressure, it exerts pressure in every direction, effectively because the molecules are moving in every direction. But it is affected by the depth, right? As you go in a swimming pool and you go deeper, your ears start to hurt because the water pressure gets greater and greater. The further down you go, the greater the pressure is. To figure out the force on the dam here, we are going to have to use calculus. I mean, maybe there's a way to approximate it or guess it exactly without calculus, but if there is, I don't know what it is off the top of my head. Partially because the sides of the dam are not vertical, they are slanted. So the cross-sectional distance here, cross-sectional areas, well, I should call it a distance, is not going to be constant. It's best when thinking about this kind of problem to think about the vertical axis going downward. And I could call it Y, but the book calls it H. So H is the vertical depth of any given thin slice. You continue on to slice these things horizontally. Let's call that H. As you go downwards, the H gets bigger. With delta H. Why am I thinking about thin slices? Because it's at an approximate constant depth. A thin slice that's horizontal like this, all the points are at an approximate constant depth. Now we need to know some things to help us continue to try to solve this problem to find the total force of water on the dam. What else do we need to know? We need to know that at a constant depth, the water pressure is constant at a constant depth. And the total force on some area at a constant depth is that constant water pressure times that area. The force is the constant pressure times the area. For example, if you've got a thin sheet of metal and it's underwater and it's horizontal, all the points are at a constant depth, the water pressure at every point is the same. If I turn it so it's vertical, like the dam, then the water pressure varies. It gets more and more pressure as you go down further. Same with the dam. The water pressure down here is higher than the water pressure up here. Just like your ears start to feel more pressure as you go down toward the bottom of the pool. But at a constant depth, you can say this, and the units would be, this is units of, pressure is force divided by area. This is newtons per square meter, square meter. This is in square meters. Yes, this is in newtons. And how do you figure out the pressure at a given depth? In general, you write this as, this is at depth H. You write this as delta times G times H, where delta is the mass density of the liquid. Which for most of your problems is water, but it could be something else. G, as usual, is the acceleration due to gravity. Mass density, that's going to be in kilograms per cubic meter. Acceleration due to gravity, that's going to be in meters per second squared. And there's your depth in meters. And this does turn out to simplify to units of meters of newtons per square meter. Though it's a little tricky to figure out. It's related to the fact that newtons is kilograms times meters per second squared. You got to use that fact. The mass density of water in the SI units, as I've already mentioned, is 1,000 kilograms per cubic meter. That's the delta. G is, of course, 9.8. And H is whatever the depth is. So in this problem, we're using SI units. If we were using British units, we would not be given delta and G separately and multiply them. We would not do 1,000 times 9.8. Instead, we'd be given the 62.4 to start with. Delta times G is 62.4. So the upshot of this is that with SI units, delta GH becomes 9,800 H newtons per square meter. And with British units, delta times G times H becomes 62.4 H pounds per square foot. Okay. Coming back to the problem at hand, this is thinking about constant depth, but now we have variable depth. But along a thin slice, that's approximately constant depth. So the small amount of force, delta F, on that thin slice of the dam, force caused by the water pressure, is that water pressure, delta times G times H, times that cross-sectional area, or the area of the thin slice, which is cross-sectional length, times its width, its height, delta H. Let's call the width W. Pressure is delta times G times H. Area is W times delta H. Pressure, area. I could have called this delta A to begin with. Again, delta is 1,000, G is 9.8, so this becomes 9,800 H times W times delta H. I am ultimately going to integrate with respect to H because I got a delta H in there. I've got to figure out how W depends on H. If this were a rectangle instead of a trapezoid, W would be constant, but it's a trapezoid, so W is not constant. I could figure out W by like drawing some triangles in here and that kind of thing. What's probably a little quicker is to just use the fact that since these, this is a trapezoid, since these are straight lines here, W is going to be a linear function of H. I could just make the graph of it and use the graph to help me figure out the formula. W is a function of H. You can see that when H is zero, I'm at the top of the dam. W is 1500. When H is 200, I'm at the bottom of the dam. W is down to 1000. The sides are straight, so this is a linear function. What's the slope? Rise over run is going to be, this is the 1000 here. Negative 500 is the rise because it goes down and the run is 200. This simplifies to negative 5/2, negative 2.5. And so the equation for W as a function of H is going to be intercepts 1500, 1500 minus 5/2 H. And you can plug that back up in here. And then this part will be the function that you integrate as H goes from 0 to 200. So the integral to do is the total force on the dam is the integral from 0 to 200 of 9800 H times W, which is in parentheses 1500 minus 5/2 H dH. Integral that can certainly be done by hand, but let's save time by using mathematics. Right, pose. Having trouble here. 5H over 2. 686 billion over 3. Okay, what is that approximately? Still over a billion, of course. About 2.29 times 10 to the 11th. We are in SI units. This would be in newtons. Is there a simple way to interpret that? I don't know. Seems kind of difficult to completely interpret that to me. Except in a completely imaginary scenario where, so you got the water on this side of the dam, get the dam here, say, water over here, and you probably have like ground over here. If it was like a science fiction movie and all of a sudden, for some reason, a wormhole appeared right here and made the ground disappear, then this force on the dam would affect how the dam starts moving. It's the only thing I could think of on the spur of the moment in the first class as how to interpret the meaning of this. Yeah, I guess what I'm trying to think about though is the meaning of the entire number, the entire force. I mean, it's easier to think about the pressure. The pressure is more where the depth of the water is greater. So the pressure is higher down here than it is up there. So the dam better be stronger down there than it is up here. It's the more practical thing to think about, I think, is the pressure rather than the total force. That's partially a function of just how big the dam is.